Yes! Sam and Max! LucasArts, you will be missed.
Welcome to another episode of The Completionist, guys. You know, I had other games lined up for this week, but after thinking a lot long and hard about what kind of transpired last week with LucasArts kind of closing down, I had to say something. You know, I'm a big point-and-click adventure kind of guy, and LucasArts, to me, really defined the genre, and there are a lot of games they produced that I feel really deserve some attention. And so, in honor of LucasArts closing down, I thought I'd review one of my favorite games to come out from there, and that, my friends, is Sam & Max Hit the Road.
Sam & Max Hit the Road. This is one delicious point-and-click mystery-solving game that I always will love. I love every bit of this one, so here's some forewarning. I might be making love to this game throughout this review.
But Batman! LucasArts! Stop! Oh, my childhood!
Don't worry there, little buddy. Let's have ourselves a good old nostalgia campfire!
Why, Disney? Why, you mouse?
As you all have probably deduced from the name of this game, we control Sam and Max. They call themselves the freelance police and solve crime. Sam is a large dog wearing a suit, and Max is a bunny with very sharp teeth.
Who does Sam remind me of? McGruff, the crime-biting dog!
Originally comic book characters, this was the first step for our heroes in video games. Our plot begins with the film noir slash monster film opening scene. A madman villain has captured a woman after going on a date, only to be condemned with the dreaded words of, "Let's just be friends."
I feel as if he may be overreacting to the situation at hand.
Enter our two fast-talking heroes, Sam and Max, who drive their car into the building, followed by Max beating the crap out of the madman. This just goes to show how awesome these two characters are. Soon after the opening credits, they receive a call to report to a carnival to help them find a missing carnival attraction, a Bigfoot named Bruno, who appears to have run off with another circus performer named Trixie. Sam and Max must travel all across the US to find Bruno and Trixie and bring them back to the circus. Along the way, they visit many made-up US landmarks and crazy adventures ensue. Right from the get-go, they get to meet a couple of loony characters who seem to be up to no good. We later find out that our main villain is a country western singer, Conroy Bumpus, who speaks with a Liverpoolian accent. Puddian? Liverpudlian. Liverpudlian. That's what the script says.
That all makes perfect sense! I really like where this game is going. Games with ridiculous plot lines make me happy.
I miss you even more, LucasArts!
The artistic design of this game just screams 1993, and I mean that in a good way. The beautiful bright colors bring back thoughts of awesome old Nickelodeon shows like Cat Dog, Rugrats, Ren and Stimpy, Rocko's Modern Life, and Ah Real Monsters. Every tourist trap destination is very detailed, and there are a lot of things that you can miss if you aren't looking close enough. There are tons of hidden jokes that pertain not only to the Star Wars franchise, but there's also a cutscene straight from Indiana Jones. And since this is a LucasArts game, there are references to other games as well. My favorite is the guy behind the counter at the store chain of Snuckies. He's the main character from Day of the Tentacle, another LucasArts game.
I feel as if that may be reviewed here pretty soon.
Leave your thoughts and comments below, folks.
Speaking of those jokes, here's a great time to talk about the voiceovers. This is one of the very first games to include full speech and music that interacts with animation. The actors that got to do the voices are simply wonderful. Sam has that old Humphrey Bogart straight voice, while Max is very wacky and off the wall, yet very level-headed at the same time. The writing is what absolutely makes this game so fantastic. I was laughing pretty much the entire time I was playing. Sam and Max's banter is just great, but then you throw in another crazy character to it, and it always turns into comedic gold.
My personal favorite was the Jimmy Stewart Bigfoot.
I told you it was a bad idea to spike the punch.
even though this game is aimed towards an older audience, it's so well written that even 10 years later, I'm still laughing at it. That's a true testament for how great writing is.
I wonder if our show will be funny in the future. Quick, let's throw a floppy disk with our shows on it in a time capsule and bury it. Then forget where we buried it, but reminisce about how hilarious we thought we once were.
Getting back on track, the music is pretty amazing too. There are multiple unique tracks that go with the theme of each area. They know that you are going to be spending a lot of time in each level, so they give you a couple tracks to listen to. Another plus is that the music always goes along with whatever's happening on screen. Now, this was very revolutionary for 1993. I said it before, but it's important to note that the writing in this game is top-notch. This is a perfect example of how good game design does not need to rely on graphics, difficulty, length, or completionist questing. The writing can be what you need to do to make a wonderful game. And that's the charm that a lot of early LucasArts games really had.
I need to go play some Jedi Knight. Kyle Katarn, here I come!
I must say that I absolutely love point-and-click adventure games. Yes, the extremely complicated games of today can be fun, but I have thousands of amazing memories of playing games like this one. Another one that comes to mind is Maniac Mansion 2, The Day of the Tentacle, which was also released the same year from LucasArts. Ah, man, I love that game.
I do miss the days of point-and-click adventures. Now it feels like if you aren't shooting someone in a video game, it gets a bad review.
So essentially what you do throughout the entire game is point and click. That's really it. It's just that simple. But it's actually a little more than just that. You primarily control Sam the dog with the subtle and awesome ability to team up with Max. When encountering people, you can choose to ask them a question, yell something at them, tell a joke, and say goodbye. You can also ask about a certain person or object if it's been brought up in prior conversations. By right-clicking on the mouse, you can literally change the action that Sam will do. The fingers miming the action to walk makes him walk, the hand grabbing the stress reliever is to commit an action, the mouth is to talk, the eye is to look at things, and the hand is to grab items to put into your inventory. The last and my favorite is the ability to grab and use Max. You can combine certain items to do certain actions using Max, and the outcome is generally quite hilarious. These games are notorious for making you really think and go backwards to go forwards. You have to revisit location after location until you have just enough information or a new item to move on. In order to fast travel, you must hop into the cop car and click on your destination that you want to go to on the map. Different places appear as you find out about them via talking to people or discovering items. You'll be hitting some weird locations like Frog Rock, the Mystery Vortex, a Celebrity Vegetable Museum, and Bumpusville, which is just like Graceland. You can also visit the three different Snuckies Roadstop restaurant locations. When it comes to items, you need to really rack your brain. You have to combine certain objects in order to progress. Let me say that some of these combinations are completely ridiculous and you would never think they'd go together. For instance, you have to combine the golf ball grabber with a claw that has a magnet just to grab a mood ring from the world's largest ball of twine. It all makes so much sense.
I'm amazed that when we were kids we could get through these games. They make you think. It's edutainment!
LucasArts definitely shows their side of simplistic fun with the several minigames they've created in this game. There's the Highway Surf, which pits Max against freeway signs. This game is kind of a one-trick pony, but you learn to appreciate this little humor within itself based on the signs that are on the freeway. There's also the mandatory Whack-A-Mole game, which is literally just as it sounds, a simple and fun Whack-A-Mole game. And you've got an equivalent to Battleship, where you literally play Battleship with cars. No bonuses provided for playing these games, it's just more fun. Another time killer, if you will.
And if you don't know where you're going, you do not need a time killer.
There really isn't a final boss or level per se, but the last place you visit is the Bigfoot Party at the Savage Jungle Inn in California. Or Nevada. California. Nevada? Kavada. California. Nijaba Nevada.
Kenyatta!
Here, you use all of your collected knowledge from all the tourist traps to solve the mystery of the four Bigfoot totems. You fool Conroy and his minion to dress up in the Bigfoot suit you created and freeze them in a block of ice. You use them as the sacrifice for the totems, and a whole bunch of trees appear. You then decide that Bruno and Trixie should be left to live their lives alone. In order to get the payment you want from the crime you solved, you then take the brand new Conroy Popsicle to the carnival and collect your reward of skee-ball tickets.
I feel that that is a satisfactory reward.
It's really impossible to lose that Sam and Max hit the road. You just explore all of America as much as you can, trying to solve the mystery of the Bigfoots. Now, this game is very old, and it is designed to run on MS-DOS, like most games of the old days. I don't encourage pirating, but you may want to emulate this if you want to enjoy the experience as much as I did. Why am I telling you this? Because the biggest struggle I had playing this game was setting it up and getting it ready to record for this review. It was actually quite tough. But regardless of that, this game is a blast from the past that cannot be forgotten. LucasArts, we will miss you.
I'm feeling a montage with cheesy music coming on.
Don't you forget about me.
Sam and Max Hit the Road is a fantastic point-and-click adventure that, in my opinion, really defined that genre. And what better way to define that genre than with a fantastic company at the time known as LucasArts. We're really going to miss you guys. I really appreciate all the hard work that all you developers did over the years. I don't care what anyone says. The Force Unleashed was a great franchise, and everything you did prior up to that was just really heartwarming and true to your guys' selves and what you did as gamers. And I think that kind of resonates with all of us at home, and we're going to miss you guys. So, with that in mind, guys, this game is my completionist rating of Complete It.
Complete It!
That is all the time we have for today, guys, so please, as always, leave your positive and negative comments in the box below. If you missed last week's episode, click right here, and if you're in the future, click right here for next week's episode. Don't forget, too, to leave your suggestions for the future of the show in the comments below. Now, if you excuse me, I'm going to go ahead and play more of that Surf Highway game while listening to awesome Star Wars music. You guys are my bros.